Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Alex Mitchell, and I'm a communications manager with the Lighthouse Lab Services marketing team. I'm here with Ann Lambrix today. She's the Vice President of Revenue Cycle Management Solutions for Lighthouse Lab Services. Ann, thanks for joining me.
Good morning, Alex.
Good morning. And today we're talking the end of the COVID-19 public health emergency. After being in place for a couple years now, that emergency is winding down and scheduled to end on May 11th, 2023. And alongside that end, a number of changes to waivers and testing flexibilities that have been in place for years now will cease to exist. So, Ann, we wanted to talk about some things labs that have been in the business of COVID testing could prepare for. So what are some of these key changes you're telling your clients to be aware of as the PHE winds down?
One of the big key changes is high throughput testing. As we all are very well aware, there was added addition of some HCPCS codes, the U003, 4, and the add-on U005, which allowed and incentivized that high throughput testing. That is going away as of May 11th. So we're going to go back to utilization of the 87635 or other panel codes that are using COVID testing.
Okay.
A couple of other things, Alex, that I think is also important is there'll be requirement of a physician order for COVID testing, and the collection codes G2023 and G2024 will also be discontinued as of May 11th.
Definitely good things for labs to be aware of. And for any lab that's still performing a very high volume of COVID testing in particular, what should they be aware of?
Again, I think most labs probably have been hopefully preparing for this for some time. As you mentioned, the PHE has been in place for several years. But some things that labs should really be aware of is, again, remembering that the reimbursement for COVID testing is going down. Will also most likely start to see patient responsibility as payers start lifting requirement to pay, have no patient out of pocket to pay in full. We may also see many payers go back to more exclusive agreements if laboratories had special contracts in place to support the COVID testing in their area. Many payers may end up terming those contracts. So again, be aware of your contract limitations, and if you go out of network, if the payer will even reimburse for COVID testing. So those are some of the things that, again, I think labs should just be prepared for. If they don't have, patient billing policy or patient pricing, most likely going to need to think about that. And again, always make sure, that they're not doing that surveillance testing and billing to insurance plans.
Those are all great points. And then let's quickly just touch on everyone's favorite subject, payer audits. Are we thinking that we might see an uptick, in that area, especially after things have gotten a little lax during the public health emergency?
And we're actually seeing it now where, especially that surveillance testing, what we're finding is that payers are looking at the utilization of testing and identifying particular trends within their system. So, if Ann Lambrix had COVID test every week for a period of, a couple months, the payer is indicating that is surveillance. And then the lab is having to support with documentation and appealing to reflect that, it wasn't surveillance, that there was necessity, potentially signs and symptoms. Again, with the PHE and the CARES Act, the CARES Act did establish coverage for basically screening. We're expecting that payers will potentially go back and try to identify if that surveillance was in fact taking place and they potentially would not pay for. Again, we're finding that the collection codes, the G2023 and G2024, are also being audited. I believe that the OIG also added the U005 on their audit list and their target list to kind of explore whether labs were using that code correctly. So absolutely, we're expecting, again, an influx of audits.
And then just quickly, Anne, if a lab were to be notified that an audit's pending and upcoming, what are just some basic steps they could take to prepare?
In my opinion, if you're getting notification from a payer, unfortunately, you know, I wouldn't say it's necessarily too late, but you will have to go through that audit and provide supporting documentation and spend some time really making sure that you have a good appeal in place to protect those monies that you received for that COVID testing. What I always recommend is doing a quick audit, an internal audit, and making sure that everything that you have been doing lines up with, again, what a payer is going to be looking for when they do come in an audit. Making sure that you have supportive documentation for the testing that you have been performing. Making sure, again, if you're using high throughput, that you've checked the boxes in regards to the requirements that were put in place for the use of that code. If you were using the collection codes, making sure that, again, you have supportive documentation to reflect the appropriate use of those codes. Again, payers are going to look for that information, and if you don't have that in place or you haven't already done some due diligence, it's going to be difficult to support. And again, you spend unnecessary, it's an administrative burden that it's put in place for the laboratories, unfortunately, but the payers are going to potentially recoup those monies. It's going to be a challenging time, I think, over the next couple of years for labs.
Definitely, I think, to say the least. Well, Anne, thank you. These are great talking points. I think things all labs that have been in the business of COVID testing and any flexibilities from the public health emergency should be aware of. As always, if you have any questions about anything we talked about here today, feel free to reach out to us and we can help clarify or provide any answers. Anne, thanks again for your time.
Thanks, Alex. Bye.
Bye.